ही बचे रामा जाए वहां इन दिस स्टुपेंडस इनएक्सप्लिकेबली मिरेकुलस मिस्टीरियस All embedded multidimensional creation of the Almighty. We used to see a perennial source of emergence, progress, their obstacles, then renaissance. It is a continuous course of action that the human race, they have witnessed by a lot of various things that happened in their socio-economical, political, religious, physical, mental, intellectual, and global issues. A very important phenomenon that governs everything in the world is consciousness emergence. Yesterday I explained about the situation analysis and progressive analysis as well as problematic studies that exist in human beings. And this type of consciousness that emerges only with either a few limited group of people or an organized structure within a limited time framework and a provincial framework. It is known as the rule of natural emergence. And it is the study of universal consciousness in which it says that whenever a problem occurs or whenever a situation rises, whenever there is a situation, somebody will have an initial or inceptive curiosity to understand the situation and to get it interpreted. When there is an imposed situation within a group of people, that type of dissatisfaction or advanced curiosity will tempt them to go for more advancement and progression. In spite of that satisfaction, still there will be a craving, which is known as persistent or continuous curiosity, which will attempt or make a person to be tempted to go for progression. Whenever in the course of progression, unavoidably progress, each and every step of progress is unavoidably coupled with their own challenges, risks, ill consequences, disabilities, dilutions, debilitations, attacks and various other unwanted things they used to couple with this type of progress. At this time, yesterday I explained how this problematic status is being pondered by human beings by their cognitive drilling, cognitive invasion, how it is put into action. So likewise, this type of consciences, this type of what we call it as also an emerging consensus. So this type of emergence that happens only in few people, it is because of the person's configurative identity and compatibility with that of the issue. Whenever there is a poverty, there are a lot of people suffering in poverty. Then a lot of people, those who are rich, who has to think about poverty? Those who are poor, they have to think about poverty because that is their problem. Those who are rich and comfortable, they have to think about the poverty because they are having unlawful enjoyment, whereas the group of the society is put into turmoil. So all the poor people, those who are being pressurized by poverty, they don't think about that. Even if they think that is not a productive thought, that could be culminated into a processing directive goal of getting into implementary services. That is not so. Even rich people, how many people will think that? So sacrifice, mercy, or problem solutions, these type of intellectual as well as clemential exercises are not executed by all members of the family. So it is told in the Shastras that, first of all, it is known as apti. Second, it is known as yapti. What is apti? Whenever there is the problem of patriotic degradation, whenever there is the problem of conversion or invasion, whenever there is the problem for cultural pressurization or cultural infiltration that happens in the nation, whenever the cruel heads of issues like poverty, unemployment, drug addiction, youth initiative problems, then various other issues of the society pertaining to various other members, wherever there is a discrimination, wherever there is a person's deprival of proper social and economical status and right, it does not occur in all minds to think about, to plan and execute. Only in few people it comes. It is known as apti. So according to the spiritual wisdom, whenever a person is getting into problem, the God, that is the substratum of universal consciousness, he has created three things. One is Vitarana, second is Avatarana, third is Avatarana. It is told that he discerns by himself and takes care of his issues. And that is something remote and it is purely philosophical and theological. Let us keep it there. The second thing is Avatarana, he delegates greater people who are capacious enough to govern these issues and provide solutions. So these solution providers, social service engineers, and troubleshooters of the social predicaments, are being delegated by the God Himself, that is Avatarana. Third thing is Vitarana. Whenever there is a problem in the society, God offers that type of emerging consciousness, that type of vigilance is offered to a particular group of people, which permeates within the group after being consolidated. It permeates to the other members of the society by means of gradual grouping. Number one, it is grouped within the like-minded people who are very strong and determined, number one. Number two, these strong and determined people, they attract also people, those who are shuffling and capricious. Third thing, those who are sleeping, those who require more consciousness emergence by means of an external stimuli, those people come under the third line. Those who are dipped in ignorance and arrogance, those who are dipped in total antagonism, skepticism, and total disastrous separation from that of the social concern, these people are very much consulted and very much concerned in the last stage. So, committed people and those people who are easily transformable, those who are somnolent, non-vigilant or kinetic in status, and the other ill members of the society who are there soaked and toasted in deep sleep of unconscious about the social concern, unconscious about the social turmoil, unconscious about the evolution of a new social renaissance. So it is known as grouping. So God creates a consciousness among a limited number of people known as apti, and this limited number of people, by means of the radiation, tejas, by means of their erudition, jnana, by means of their compassion, daya, also by means of proper organizational methodology, now the science has given information technology for information security, information governance, information data mining, preservation, orderliness, and spreading to everybody, we have all provisions. Printing technology is there. So this type of oral propagation, this type of propagation methodologies which are conventional have been replaced by very potential media tools. So, this type of a grouply organized, systematic, spontaneous emergence of dynamic consciousness is distributed effectively to people of a recent lenience and proclivity towards the goal of the organization. It is known as apti and vyapti. And whatever he has told now, it is something very sensational. There are two types of things, that which is immediately required and short-term benefited or ephemeral. That which is maybe long-term or not directly connected, but that has a deeper impact to the society. Our connection with the milkman, grocery man, our connection with school fees and paying rent and electricity, phone bill, these things are immediate. We are directly connected. And everybody is more concerned about our direct issues. But in long run, the national security, political decency, democratic rights of the people, integrity among the community, these things are no doubt as emergent as the fire service, ambulance, police attention, etc. But those things, we consider that as they are not of so instantaneous and direct. See, there are two things. In social mentality of a person, each and everybody has two dimensions. One is a socio-national dimension. Second is socio-personal dimension. Whenever a person has a socio-personal dimension, his wife and children, his domestic rights and liabilities, they come forward. No doubt, we have to execute that. But the socio-national dimension has equal emergency that these things are to be executed. Number one, even though we are not directly concerned, each and every impact that is there due to the imbalance of national, social, economical security measures, they affect us, affect our business, affect our livelihood, may affect our lives also, because it is not sure. It will certainly affect our future generations. So we should also use our socio-national dimension. And yesterday I told that expecting a nation to do is so idiotic. It is the duty of any person to integrate within himself and also with others. They should awaken, they should admonish, they should protest against the ruling party, and they should see that somebody, rules should obey the rules, or somebody, those who are ruling, they should obey the rules, or somebody, those who are going to obey the rules, or persons to be selected for ruling. Either we should see that the rulers obey the rules, or we should see that the obeyers of the rule are made as rulers. That is our democratic integral right that we have to make. And coming into Adhyayana, whenever you see a problem, it is known as analytical study. You must understand the ontological situation, you must understand the teleology, the purpose of any act, the base of any act, the multidimensional dimensional issues of ADX. So you must know the source, origination, various other dimensional studies, contemporary study, futuristic study, what is the infrastructure and the power available with us, and what are the things to be done, what are the things that are lacking, how to procure them. These things are systematic, analytical, logistic, strategical study of what we are going to do for any problem. It may be personal or national or global. So everything that is understood is known as avagamana, and anything that is understood with depth is known as adhyayana, and anything that is researched with application tools properly designed is known as anusandhana, and implementation of the same thing is known as anusthana. So these things are the four limbs of knowledge, and wherever you see panigrahana is a specific nomenclature. It is known as pradhana namakarana, in which you call all marriages as panigrahana, that is holding the hand. But by mentioning just holding the hand, it does not mean that the marriage ceremony consists of only holding the hand. Holding the hand is one among the innumerable ceremonies, as it is having some prominence or attraction or some set of climax significance in that totalitarian issues of various other ceremonial rites being prescribed. It is given a prominence in the nomenclature. Adigrahana is prominent among the various actions. Likewise, if you say adhyayana, it starts with avagamana. You should understand things deeply with a personalized approach. Whatever, see, that is the greatness of patriots. Who are patriots? For example, that's what I told in the lecture on charity. If you feel that you are hungry, that is an instinct. If you feel that somebody else is hungry, that is charity. So whenever you feel for something else, whenever your impact or whenever your self-instinctive stimulus is very much broadened for external and extended efforts, then you are becoming a cosmopolitan citizen, you are becoming a dutiful citizen, you are becoming also a beautiful citizen for yourself, for the nation, within your possible might. Likewise, each and every person, just as in his physical organism, wherever he gets wound or injury, the whole system is disturbed. Likewise, in the social mechanism, being the part of the social mechanism, he is a component of the social compound. So anything that happens conspicuously, anything that happens visibly in the society should disturb, otherwise the person is having a problem. Any person with a free mind, any person with an impeccable mental status and spiritual mooring, certainly he will see that anything that happens in the society disturbs him, and it tells the person to have an intellectual boost to derive a solution. So you have mentioned adhyayana, that includes also avagamana, then coming into adhyayana, then coming into anusandhana. Whatever the speaker who has told, very much he has created an alert, alarm, and also aversion. Aversion about the allergy forces, alarm about the impending dangers, and alert for the people to go for preemptive measures he has created. That is known as anusandhana. It should be put into anushtana. Each and every member should do that. Why it is not happening? I told about vyapti. Vyapti is pervasion. See, whenever you are teaching somebody, it should go deeper and broader. If you talk with 10 people, it should reach the abysmal core of a person's executive skill, so that he thinks, even if he goes there, it should be deeply carved inside the abysmal core of a mind, so that in spite of going back to his house, in spite of being flooded and crowded and clouded by his routinal daily works and pressures, in spite of having various other commitments and various other diversifications in life, still he should have a corner by which he is continuously thinking about that, which is lingering and lingering in their ears and mind. Number one. Number two, whatever a person carries from here, it should be conveyed to the working people, effective people, targeted audience. Each and everybody should be a deeper receiver of the knowledge and a broader transmitter of the knowledge. Then only it will spread to a lot of people. How it will be possible? It will be possible only by two means. One, the person who carves, he should be a very, very highly incorporated potential person. Either the deliverer of the lecture should be a great acharya. Because of his power, his radiance, his penance and austerity, he could make it deeper. Because each and every person is naturally inclined towards a negative pressure. They are very much attracted to physical attraction, oratory powers, various other dramatic presentations and projections by which politicians, media people, everybody, they are attracted to the society to get attracted with genuinity, to get attracted with serenity, purity, sanctity and divinity, to get attracted with something that is transcendental, real, eternal and perennial. It requires a different understanding, different power of absorption. That assimilation is not there with common people. They are attracted only by ephemeral peripherals. That should be a radiant person to see that they are sealed indelibly with the mark of wisdom, the mark of patriotism, the mark of productive benevolence by which he can serve the society with real ease and comfort. The second thing, even though if the person is not so, in the case of Gandhiji, you know that he saw the Harichandra drama and he got some transformation as per his biography. And the same drama has been acted, even the person who has acted, whether he has transformed or not, after acting in the same drama for decades, that is a question. But still, even if the other side is not pure or genuine, if it creates even an imaginary structure or sheath of genuinity, it creates real impact in the minds of the people, provided that they are so benefited and blessed by a divine framework. So either the deliverer of the message or receiver of the message should be hyper-potentialized with a divine structure, unless with efficacious spreading of the message will not be there. Naturally, anybody creating awareness in the society, they are God sent. Anybody, those who are creating vigilance in the society, you see, it may catch fire. As your hut is near to firewood station, it may catch fire. That is the first alarm. Second is your neighbor's hut is catching fire. It may spread to you. That is the second alarm. Your hut is on fire. That is the third alarm. All alarms have been given, and the alarm givers have been totally exhausted. Even after witnessing and experiencing various incidents of untold miseries, melancholic, cyclic perpetuality, still the people, they have not got the essential, sufficient type of vigilance by which they can control. After some show or some scene is organized for 2 or 3 weeks, whenever there is a sensational issue, afterwards they become very casual and normal, as if nothing has happened. It is the mind of a great yogi. Gatasun, agatasuchya, namhochanti panditaha. For the people alive and dead, no distinguishing is made by great scholars or renowned people. It is a statement of Bhagavad Gita. It is not for social operation. These people are becoming irresponsibly ascetic in nature, so that they behave as if they are renowned. So we want to have a perennial vigilance in the society. Whenever they are getting into problem, immediately there is something. He has mentioned about appeasement of minorities. It is only for, not only for minorities. Poor people, how they can be appeased, how farmers can be appeased, how women can be appeased. The people are technical and tactical. Whether they are having clemency and compassion or not, they are having a concrete system of tactics, how they can utilize or exploit the weakness of the society. This type of appeasement or diversion of issues towards various things. Whenever there is a problem coming, immediately it is diversified somewhere else, so that this thing is forgotten. Somebody used to tell one story, when these farmers agitated in the period of Indira Gandhi, immediately each and every village was supplied a good TV. At that time only Doordarshan was there. And if the people enjoyed Doordarshan, how they would have been suffering in their family? The suffering would have been comparatively more. If a person could enjoy Doordarshan, he should have a comparatively greater suffering. So that was given as a diversifier, a diverter for the minds of the people in the earlier years. So Adhyayana is a full-time structure which includes Avagamana, then being processed by Anusandhana and Adhishtana. And now coming to the real point, what is Vishwadhyayana? It may be lot of things may be there in your principles, in your budgetary exercises, and in your operative modules. According to me, Vishwadhyayana is Vishwasya Adhyayana, Vishwabhavena Adhyayana, Vishwamukha Adhyayana, Vishwam Adhikritya Adhyayana, Vishwena Adhyayana, Vishwaya Adhyayana. Innumerable things we can make from samasa. Number one, Vishwadhyayana, technically it shows cosmology, to know about the world and its origin. That we know already, we don't think about all of these things. We have emerged and expanded. Now what we are going to do is more emergent. Second thing is Vishwadhyayana, understanding about the common aspects of the global emergence in socio-political and economical issues for having a common governance or understandable mutual brotherhood in various nations. Number three, Vishwadhyayana means Vyapaka Adhyayana, to have a universal or multidimensional or consummate vision of Indian tradition of knowledge. Number four, application of Indian tools of yoga, Ayurveda, Vedanta and other traditional sciences for psychopathology and epistemopathology and ontopathology of the whole global kingdoms. Number five is understanding the contribution of the contemporary status of India for the emerging global things in science, technology and other social variations. Understanding about the place of India as a superpower or as a power or as a surviving, establishing and progressing nation in the global scenario. Impact of the global development, global culture, intercultural clashes as well as communal clashes that exist inside and outside India, and the role of them either reducing and debilitating the standardization of political, social, economical and general survival decencies of our land. So we can just keep on giving 10 or 15 exemplifications by just taking the word Vishwadhyayana. So it is about the world. It is about the contribution of India for the world. It is about the impact of the universe for, that is, the worldly nations and their situations for India. It is also understanding with a comparative style. It is understanding about a futuristic world where everybody can amicably survive and serve each other. So this type of various contemporary, historical, futuristic, multidimensional, mutual visions can be made for this Vishwadhyayana. And coming to that, everything starts by history. There are two things. Anybody working without studying history, he is an idiot, because without understanding the proper mental setup as well as development setup of these people over generations and over periods, it is not easy for a person to implement something for the contemporary status. So anybody without studying coming for contemporary studies is an idiot. Anybody studying mere history, not interested in contemporary application, is a lunatic. So we must not be either. One should have a strong base of historical grounds wherever we have to learn from things. Whenever we learn about our failures, we get boosted emergence of our willpower and dynamism. If we are positive, we will shelter into revenge if we are negatively dimensionalized. So we must know about the success stories. We must know about the achievements of our ancestors. We should know about the purity. We should know about the greatness of those people. We should know about the cleavage that exists. In some places, we appear to be advanced. In some places, they appear to be more advanced than us. We have lost a lot of things. They have gained a lot of things. We are gaining a lot of things. Perhaps they may not be having the same thing which we are having now. In this mutual study of historical past as well as the contemporary present, there will be gaps, cleavages, dimensional variations and distinctions that we have to understand. And when coming into the real historical perspective, first of all, any person should not have lost the opportunity of studying the values of their heritage. It is very important. Otherwise, a strong, determined patriotism cannot be inculcated in people, those who don't know about the pride of the nation, the glory of the nation. When compared to that, I think there are a lot of things in rewriting history. Now there was a seminar about rewriting the history of India. Because history is always authored by people, those who are Eurocentric. Whenever somebody is authorizing, there are two problems. One is chauvinism, second is bias. If you author your own nation's history, then you may be very much interested in boosting it. So there will be a lot of chauvinistic reports. If it is 10,000, you will say it is 35,000. If a biased person comes, he will say 10,000, he will remove two zeros and say it is just 100 years. So it should be unbiased, it should be logistic. See, for all things we cannot get evidences. There are a lot of evidences. One is a revelation and realization evidence. It is known as paramaterial evidence, in which for each and everything we cannot see for an inscription. Inscription is an evidence, numismatics is an evidence, paleography is an evidence, archaeology is an evidence, epigraphy is an evidence, historical tradition is also an evidence. Apart from this, there is some sort of realized, proven evidence by means of assessing the mental maturity and intellectual maturity of our ancestors, which cannot be an evidence by mere archaeological inscriptions. So that type of evidence should increase the pride of our people in knowing about the nation. And whenever there is the Eurocentric invasion, in making the history, there are a lot of things into. At the time of the greatest literature or the first literature that is there in record in the world, Rig Veda, when it evolved, whenever there is a literature evolving, before thousands of years at least, even if you accept the gradual accumulation theory of a linguistic development or philological development, there should have been first some sort of phonetics, some sort of acoustics, first some sort of gesticulation and sound making. It is known as the science of semichics, in which they make gesticulations, emblems, signs and symbols. The first initial way of communication that should have been matured into some way of sounds, then sounds being properly put into various things like orthography in the form of writing, then getting into etymology, terminology, orismology, semantics, syntax, grammar and various other limbs of philology. It would have taken thousands of years, even before 2500 BC, to have that origination developed. If a language development takes that much of time, then conceptive development, conceptive revelation of the Rig Veda, that would have taken thousands of years. If revealing the conceptation, see, somebody if they think about the concept, immediately they may not say. The concept that has been hidden, that has been moduled inside, that would have taken lot of years. Because to think about something, it is a process. To think everything with coordination is the second process. To integrate the coordination in a proper structure is the third process. To put them everything in a structure known as a grammar, that framework, is the fourth process. Then revealing them in the form of literature with a proper compilation as a compendium is the fifth process. Then propagation by means of a disciplinic and disciplic succession, guru parampara, that is the process. Even if we say that, that takes a lot of years, wherein by we did not see any trace of civilization. Those people, they were in absolute nudity of both civilization as well as the methods of survival in the whole global communication. So the Eurocentric theory is they were not happy to hear that, because that which is before Christianity or that which is before the civilization era of the Europe, they won't accept. Even the greatest civilizations, for example, Arab is there. Arab country, the lot of pre-Islamic religions were there which have been trampled. The only greatness of our land is it has a composite growth or a collective growth. Somebody told that there is no God, that is Sankhya school of thought. They told that there is no God, only nature and human beings, or nature and living beings, or nature and souls. It was accepted and given a status in a land. And Kanada told that everything is by an atomic emergence, Paramanuvada, there is no God, it is accepted. Only rituals are there and there is no God, Dirishwara Mimamsavada, it is accepted. There is God and has different forms, it is accepted, Cheshwara Mimamsavada. So, Nayayika, Vaisheshika, Sankhya, Yoga, Pasupada, Madhyamika, Sautrantika, Vaibhashika, Yogachara, Arhata, Bhata, Prabhagara, Shankara, Dvaita, Yadava, Prakasha, Dvaita, Dvaita, Advaita, Bhava, Dvaita, Achitya, Veda, Veda, innumerable mutually discriminate and contradictory systems evolve and collectively survive in a land. There may be some clashes, either moral clashes or criminal clashes. That is the mistake of the organization, not mistake of the natural structure of the code of conduct of our land. So there are these pre-Islamic religions having innumerable things of paganism, whereby they preserved innumerable personifications for each and every force of the land. How we can compel a person to accept only one language or one food. Likewise, different type of God, it is natural. This type of system, pre-Islamic religions, even they say that there were perishing Arabs like Ad community and Thamud community. This Ad and Thamud community, they are real Arabs and they are perishing now. Second thing is the Quaternarians of the Arabs, who are the real pure Arabs. And this Ismail tradition of the Abraham, they are known as Arabized Arabs, even by the Arab history. So these people are Arabized. They entered, they dominated. See, whatever they are telling about the Aryans is really done by the Christian and Islam community. These people, they have been Arabized by means of their settlement in just 650 AD. And at that time, whatever that existed, by means of the various traditions of the world, they had innumerable things. Nassatian community. Nassatian community existed, Quaternarian community existed, then Himyarka community, Himyarka dynasty that existed, innumerable dynasties and innumerable personified forces of nature like zoolatry, herbolatry, worshipping of trees and nature, everything existed there. It was totally trampled. So whenever a community, but there are two things, which was the place of origination and which is a place for survival. There are two questions, which was the place of origination, which is the place for survival. In which everything flourished should be the place of origination, in which everybody was allowed to survive, that should be the place for survival of people. So likewise, everything flourished from our land, innumerable thoughts. I have already told, in English we can say philosophically, substantialism, existentialism, atomism, neotheism, pantheism, metatheism, megatheism, innumerable things we can add in the form of Sanskrit, whatever I have told. So everything flourished here, it should be the origin. Everything is still surviving here, and there is a decency, lenience and proper licensing for everybody to practice their own things within a reasonable limit, without clash, without any collision. There should be contact, there should be communication, there should not be any sort of clash and collision. So that has been administered here. So it is the land of survival, it is the land where everybody originated, it is the destination land for everybody. Even though they live at other lands, for any knowledge transmission, for any satisfaction, for any solace and embrace, for getting intellectual or spiritual boost, or even at the time of their tiring nature which they are going to do after a lot of technical inventions, one day they are going to fed up with technology, they have to come for a divine training, they have to come for their own rejuvenation by means of a spiritual process, and this is the land. And second thing is Iranians. Iranians, Persians, they are having a very great traditional history. Even at the time of our flourishing, Iranians, they have no history at all. The greater Irania, that included Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Iran, Iraq, various other regions, you know, even Turkey, Afghanistan, everything is included in the mega Iranian province. And there were Bags, there were Persians, and there were even great tribes like Zoroastra civilization that existed in Persia, and even the Amlite situation, that is, there were two civilizations, one is Proto-Amlite and second is Amlite. So Proto-Amlite and Amlite civilization that existed, Zoroastra civilization existed, they were worshippers of nature and they were very much adhering to our own civilization. And even the cradle of civilization of Rome and Greek, Rome, it started only in the 9th century BC, Then we were flourishing with Rig Veda, which has information about palaces, civil engineering technology, navigation technology, agriculture, animal husbandry, coinage, stampage, everything, all type of transmission, communication, transportation, and high advanced methods of survival have been mentioned at the time of which they have been just sleeping and crawling at the cradle whenever they mentioned about some issues like Romulus and Pompilius. At that time, their knowledge is imported from three sources: China, Arab and Greece. It is saying that this knowledge has been, see, how we can understand the origin of a particular transaction. There is a logical question. If somebody is having more and if somebody is receiving something, there will be a possibly logistic way of understanding their possessions and evaluating who will be the receiver and who will be the bestower. Likewise, at that time, we have been having innumerable shastras like Rasavada, Kautukvada, Bipilavada, Agneya Vidya, Varuna Vidya, Chaudhamini Kala, Mantra Shastra, Jyotish Shastra, Vaidya Shastra, Vijnana Shastra, Tantrika Vijnana, Arthaveda, Dhanurveda, Ayurveda, Gandhara Veda, innumerable things that have been existing. So a complete structure is seen in our land, and only traces of our wisdom is there imported through migration, colonization by means of messengers' visit and total. At that time they were having intellectual tourism, often they used to send messengers. So invasion, colonization, migration, trade and messengership, that has created some transaction of our knowledge to three routes. One is Indo-China route, and second is Indo-Greek route, and third is Indo-Arab route, which has resulted in the formation of sciences like mathematics, astronomy, astrology, metallurgy, meteorology, textile technology, and various other institutions. We did not deny the development of the West. We are telling everything because if a nomadic civilization and a new civilization could prosper more, what were the reasons that so advanced people could not prosper competitively? Why we are in a degraded position? Not to create some sort of past boasting, or not to create some sort of self-flattery of our own culture and civilization. It is for understanding the failure investigation of our development, which was stagnate for a long period by means of colonization, invasions, Muslim invasion, various other things, and dilution of our own standards. That's what I told you in one seminar. It is a very wonderful statement that I quoted. Also, I quoted the same thing. Those people who are empowered by yoga and Vedanta, those people entered into mere shastras, quarreling with each other with logics. So that type of spiritual power making or empowerment with spiritual exercises have been reduced to mere quarrelsome or debating sciences. Those debating sciences are also, that intellectual, dry intellectual quest are also mitigated and transformed or reformed into the process of fine arts. They have been showing more interest in art, architecture, music, painting and dancing and other various exercises. When these people have been very much slowed down, when they have been totally disorganized and dismantled from spiritual empowerment, this invasion, colonization, everything occurred at the time of which they have lost their constitutional immunity of the land and spiritual immunity of their practices and determination. That is a major reason. It is for the failure investigation of these things. Likewise, in China also, we have the Xing dynasty and Shang dynasty. Even we start from the Paleolithic as well as the Neolithic ages until the Wing dynasty and Qing dynasty of the 190 AD, starting from 2700 AD. Still, each and everybody, they have some history. There are three types of nations. One nation, that which has no historical record and civilization record. That which land is occupied by just tribes, where penal colonies or uninhabited colonies or tribally or native occupied colonies which have been invaded or just migrated and occupied by people. That is the first level of nations. The mediocre level of nations, those who have civilization, some civilization in a riverbank, wherein they know how to clothe, how to make the shelter, how to make everything. These are all the marks of initial civilization, not inner civilization, initial civilization. That is the second thing. Those who are having the perennial fragrance of the eternally unfadable greenness of civilization with the truth and utmost completion and consummation, that people, they are said to be the superior in nature. What is civilization? We described in the lecture. The ability of a person to understand and react three things: that which is around him, that which is behind him, that which is beyond him, that is known as civilization. That which is around a person is known as environment and society, human beings. That which is behind everything is known as science. That which is beyond everything is spiritualism. Spiritualism, science and society, this triple S, if it is understood, organized and executed, that is the mark of civilization. I know how to clothe and I know how to inside in a cave, I know how to cook in fire. These things are just instinctive derivations or drivings of civilization. Now we are having all the people, those who are now terrorists, they are very decent, educated, they know how, they are computer literate, they are Anglo literate, they are well civilized, but the inner civilization is not there with them. That is the problem. So whenever we are taking the history, first duty of Vishwadhyayana Kendra, Vishwadhyayana means anybody interested in understanding the universal outframe of Hinduism or our Dharma is known as Vishwadhyayana. The first meaning I have already told. Like that, they have to understand the history. They have to understand not the inscriptive history, but a para-historical record or an auto-historical record which is based on belief, which is not superstitious, but super-institutional by means of understanding somebody is great, unintelligible, or far beyond the records of historical pronouncement. So this is the greatness of historical understanding, where we have to outrule so many things like Aryan invasion theory. Recently, they have outruled Aryan invasion theory by saying that there are a lot of tests, physical anthropology. Those who are dark skinned and bright skinned, even the same traditions of the native people who are existing here called to be Dravidians, they have invented a lot of people who are having the physical, anthropological, chromatic or complexion status of having a bright skin like Aryans. And second, the materials archaeology, whatever they got from Indus Valley, they are very much compatible to that of the Vedic religion. And third thing is archaeogenetics. Archaeogenetics, linguistics, historical references in the Vedas, they understood that there was a Saraswati river civilization, the places mentioned by the Aryans, that absolutely the places that have been mentioned here, and they are very much native of our people. Like that, we have to have some sort of rectification of our own land, that number one, we are senior most people in civilization, we have a broader civilization, we have a complete civilization, not only instrumental civilization, but also inner civilization. Number fourth thing, and we are inhabitants, and this knowledge is our own native knowledge, and it is also for universal bestowal. You have to understand two things. We should not think that it has come from somewhere else. It has come for us, from us, and it is not covered exclusively for our development. It is to be distributed whenever the world has some sort of readiness or preparedness to open 2 years. If it is before 200 or 300 years, nobody in the West was prepared to hear about yoga, about Ayurveda. Whenever all the doors are closed for their solace, for their comfort, for domestic harmony, for physical health, whenever science and technology has become additional disasters along with the national disasters and natural disasters, then the people, they survived only in the hope of getting hopeful drive or a ladder uplift from our own nation. So now the society in a position to understand the greatness of Vedas, which they would not have understood before 2 or 3 centuries. So this is, we should understand the history, rewrite the history, establish the history, and that's what I told in a seminar, what do you think about your culture? Then I told that whenever I think of my culture, I am proud. Whenever I see my culture in the present stage, I feel painful. I feel grateful if I think about my culture. But if I see my culture, I feel painful. If I feel that I have not contributed much or sufficient, I feel shameful. That's what I told. That should be the spirit of each and every fool, every person, those who are existing in the same community. They should feel grateful for the past and painful for the present and shameful for their non-participation or inadequate participation. And they should design themselves that they are proper tools for that thing. And apart from that, linguistic, you should do surveys on some research orientation, especially on linguistics and literature of our land and how it is very much applicable to modern problems, emerging predicaments and their solutions. That is known as linguistic survey. It is very much essential. Third thing is arts and sciences. Now recently they have made NBIC convergence, nanotechnology, biotechnology, infotechnology, cognotechnology convergence. In the cognotechnology, what the scientists know is, if you can't remember things, you create a chip. Either by a neuroprosthetic or a software chip, you have to replace your ability. Not creation of inner ability is the destination or determination of modern science. To replace everything by a scientific or technical matter and to keep you perennially incapable or handicapped or techno-dependent is the present status of technology. I delivered 2 lectures about NBIC convergence, and I am guiding a lot of people in developing inner cognitive ability skill by which we can invent more things and create more fusions and utility designs in nanotechnology, biotechnology and infotechnology. We are designing that. Like that, what is the modern status in physical, intellectual and mind making, emotional balancing, talent boosting, talent identification, multi-versatility, extra power memory, multilinguistic skills, whatever that is applicable, whatever that is traceable for a modern need, we have to develop some sort of adhyayana. That is Vishwadhyayana. Vishwadhyayana is making a curriculum or a system of knowledge by which our traditional knowledge can suit any time, any demand for any person, for any benefit. So it is known as Vishwadhyaya. So it is attunement of our own knowledge which should be redesigned, or it should be very much assembled in such a design so that it can accommodate any system, any demand to any gravity of any person in any corner of the world. That is Vishwadhyaya. And one more thing I want to say about the greatness of our land, very simple thing. Number one, four things occurred in the world. One is creation of the world, and the second thing is evolution of living, that is living beings like life. Third thing is evolution of human species. Fourth thing is evolution of civilization. First the universe was created, then life was evolved, then human beings they evolved, then the fourth thing is civilization, they are civilized. These four things are very much mechanical and accidental in modern science. So when everything is, how universe was formed by a Big Bang conjecture? How did it occur? By means of an explosion. Primordial cosmosynthesis, Riemannian geometry, Weyra geometry, hot and cold dark matter, black holes, everything that deals with a particular stage, beyond which it is known as accidental explosion. How life was formed? There was a droplet of protoplasm which accidentally formed out of some other special combination in the astral surface. Basically a droplet that has fallen down and by means of an instigatory consciousness that is assembled by means of an accidental phenomenon, that developed into amoeba, paramecium, then annelida, arthropoda, mollusca, platyhelminthes, echinodermatous. This is the modern science. Whereas we designed, the world was created for a purpose by a god. It is created by an intelligent person. It has rules and regulations. It has some ethics or order of living. If something is accidental, we can live like anything. If something is accidental, how you will have systematism, principalism and precision in your accidental system? So we believe this civilization is a predestined divine plan. Evolution is a divine condition, satya sankalpa. Evolution of life, it is by means of the theogenesis, but is the will of God. And the whole universe was created as a substratum for to organize ourselves and liberate ourselves, which is a provided divine opportunity that is offered by the divine munificence. So by munificence, by clemential shower, by means of his magnanimity, by means of his cravingness to uplift us and to give us liberation, God has created everything. So if you understand everything as a proper design, purposeful design, intellectual design, perfect and precise design, then you get everything, perfection, precise, modulation, self-systematization, everything will naturally come. That is why the accidental science theory has resulted in all accidents. Cosmic accident, traffic accident, global accident, everywhere there is an accident in each and every dimension of science. So we have to understand this major thing. It is a basic substratum of life. And one more thing I want to say, I have just quote because of lack of time. There are few issues of our culture we have to explain. Idolatry. The kafirs who have been mentioned in that Middle East countries are entirely different from us. Those who are assuming forms for God, for their facility is different from, we believe that God, out of their mercy, they occupy some forms because to facilitate our jnana. In our system of idolatry or archavatara, we say that God, out of his merciful wish, he simplifies himself so that he is accessible to us. So idolatry is an issue in our things. Then animal sacrifice is a problem. Transmigration or continuity of birth is a problem. God is even born in the world, incarnation, that is an issue. Then adoration. God is treated as a human and human is worshipped as God. This is adoration. God is given food, cloth, everything. That is the human form of adoration of God. And great people in other cultures, they don't worship people. Acharyas and Bhagavatas, devotees and preceptors, they worship. It is adoration principle. So transmigration and also incarnation and adoration. Then animal sacrifices in rituals. Then the caste system of the society, these other issues, you have to contact in Vishwadhyaya Kendra, separate seminars, wherein by, if they are, there are three possibilities. If they are time-bounded, we can make it obsolete. If we are interpretation-bounded, then we can give the real interpretation and say that these things are misinterpreted. Even if they are exploitations of the society and interpolations, we can say that they don't reflect the real Vedic society, they are interpolation by the successors. There are three philosophies. One is the interpolation possibility, second is the proper interpretation possibility, and the third thing is to consider that it is time-bounded, kalatita, that it is obsolete. So we have to create in the adhyayana various sources of knowledge. And coming to the practical and concluding session, what we want to know is, number one, we are having three issues. One is the conversion issue, second is the invasion issue, and the third thing is placement issue. There are two things. We cannot prevent in a democratic society, that too in the pseudo-secular society, it is very difficult to to replace somebody or to organize something different. Everybody is emerging in good standards. Now if you see, there is a report in which judiciaries, ruling party, bureaucrats, everybody, they are representations from the Dushta Chatushtaya, which Hanuman Chaudhary, he is from Pragya Bharati, he used to say in Mahabharata there is Dushta Chatushtaya. That is Dushasana, Duryodhana, Karna and Shakuni. They were collectively known as Dushta Chatushtaya. He told the same thing as the first Dushta is M. Makale, Lord Makale. Second M is Muslim. Third M is Vishnu. Fourth M is Marxism. These four things have been collectively given a name by Hanuman Chaudhary as Dushta Chatushtaya. So in this pseudo-secular society, wherein by in the pretext of minority protection means it is only protecting minority. It does not mean that minority is also protected. The real definition for minority protection is wherever there is a possibility for two things. The minority being disintegrated, collapsed, economically deprived, they should be weak. The majority being so atrocious and integrated, there is a possibility of insecurity or possibility for some sort of collapse and collision between majority and minority. It should be administered, this drug should be administered only in the area where there is predominance of the majority, where there is a debilitation for minority like Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, etc. It can be minority protection should be made. And in some area where the majority is totally disintegrated, the minority is hyper potentialized and immigrated, we have to enact only the majority protection act, not the minority protection act. So like that, in this society, growing society like this, only possibility is placement. That too we have to fight with the reservation and see that we are placed in merit. Most of the people in the judiciary, either they are direct representatives of this four Chatushtaya or they are supporters directly or indirectly of them. The whole industry, I am not joking, in all bureaucratic services, in judicial services and in media services, if you do a research, most of the media services like Times, then Aajtak, NDTV, most of the things, most of the journalists are prepared by Jawaharlal Nehru University. Wonderful, that's what I am saying, we have to create some sort of merit status, IAS Training Institute, Journalism Training Institute, some sort of training institute for bureaucratic placement, political placement, industrial placement, then social animators placement, NGO placement, everybody they have a design, like Ravana came in the form of Sanyasi, so that there will be a credibility and accountability. Like that, we have clearly talked about NGOs. Most of the NGOs, instead of directly entering into some set of arms and ammunition, transfer, immoral trafficking, drug trafficking, then smuggling, and also conversion in the pretext of social service by means of creating a pseudo-structural tears in their eyes and creating a pretextual method of pretentious praying and healing systems, it is being done by the society. So these NGOs, most of the people, they have only two things. One thing is infiltration. And the second thing is conversion. Infiltration by debilitating the society, the social security and the social economy by means of doing all the malicious and heinous crimes in the society. So NGOs, proper NGOs, proper media people, proper judiciaries, proper bureaucrats, silently we have to permeate like Chanakya instructed Chandragupta. Chandragupta immediately attacked the center and he was subjected to a successful failure. At that time there was a story told to me, and these two people, they have been taking some food. Dosha, they have been taking dosha in a village hut due to their heavy appetite. At that time Chandragupta, due to this over enthusiasm or his killing appetite, he directly pinched some dosha from the center. Then that old lady, it seems that she has advised, you see, you should start from this surroundings. Gradually when you have been taking this surroundings inside, gradually the heat will be mitigated so that you can approach the center. What she has expressed in the dosha technology, he has understood his dosha. From the dosa he has got the knowledge about his dosha, then he has created first border attacking, creating infrastructure inside, slow penetration, then obtaining some techniques and tacticalities of intelligence and propaganda mechanism, gradually he entered inside. Like that we should Vishwa Dhyana Kendra, it is not only talking and discussing, we have to establish training centers by which shining stars of future media industry, productive industrial technology, science, academicians, everybody should be incubated from that so that we can have a replacement. Because we cannot stop them growing, but we can create a big line by which they can be beat until, that is the only immediate possibility we are having, that number one. Number two, apart from this thing, conversion is a problem. I told you in seminar, it is very wonderful, I want to say it in a simple brevity. Whenever you change the attire and attitude, everything will be gradually changing. That's what I told you. if you just convert yourself from a tough to a crab, immediately you will lose the integrity of your spiritual will. It starts with a dress, then it comes into design, then it comes to demeanor, then it comes into discipline, then characteristic infiltration and fusion will occur. You will lose integrity, or you will lose your approach or determination with your own culture. So your dress, your language, if you talk in English, I am also talking in English, it is the process by which Rama has made in his Ramavatara. Likewise, by talking in English, English is sanctified, but because we used to handle this English for propagation of truth and eternity. Likewise, some set of design, some set of attire that we have, it should be also our own nature. At least even if it is not possible holistically, on occasions we should wear our dress, we should wear our own mask. Whenever you are there in your own reality, your determination gets deepened, broadened and widened. So somebody should say that these are external set of gimmicks and some set of hypocrisy. Not like that. Your language, your dress, your tilak and your ways of observation, each and everything is the unit of consolidation of your belief, making you strong and staunch. So you have to do that. But there are also two types of people, paracritics and hypocritics. Those who are wearing everything but against the civilization is a hypocritic. Those who are not wearing but still has an inner zeal and working for that is a paracritic. It may be exceptional, but it should not be regulatory. Everybody should have a belief in that. Why conversion and saving? Because if a person adopts a religion of a different land, immediately his affinity towards the land, nationalization, everything will be diluted. It is natural. Even in cricket or in any other thing, they will be very much affiliated to the religion and the land of the religion more than the land in which they dwell. That is very natural. It is unavoidable. It is there. So we have to see these three things. One is conversion, and second is, yes, thought about the cross-border security. I made a project about Bangladesh infiltration. I stayed there in the Brahmaputra Tira at Panibandar for a few days, and we noticed a lot of things like that. And I have also done some research articles and conducted two seminars on this thing. What are people have been telling about Bangladesh infiltration? Nobody is caring. After a decade, only Bangladesh is going to be a big headache for these people, because everybody, they are rationalized and nationalized. Everybody is having some identity, like this ration card, voter ID, everything, and they are well settled. And those people, because they don't have any livelihood, I have created a project for borders. In the border of Bakshar, where in Bihar, if you want to go to Nepal, if you give 50 rupees, you can go there. If you give 100 rupees, you will be carried on the shoulder. So what I have told is, you have to thicken the population of borders by constructing education institutions, industries and colonizing large people. If you are having some sort of movement of people there, then it can be really tightened. Some sort of measures, 10 ideas we have given to the people, they have not listened. So we have to be afraid. The whole Northeastern community has been neglected by all people, religious people and political people. All the religious heads, they are stationed only at few places like Gujarat, Rajasthan and Maharashtra, which is the hub of plutocratic and aristocratic authorities. It is a plutonic center. It is center of Lakshmi. So they have totally avoided the Northeastern area, where it has become now the warehouse or repository of thugs, criminals, then non-state reactors, terrorists, conversion agencies like missionaries. It has been totally outruled. How they have lost most of the lands. Northeast is totally lost in spite of possession. Still it is lost because you cannot create a splendor. Holding a land is not your possession. Ability to instill your faith and ability to incorporate and blend with the nature of the land is the real possession. Anybody will be having a lot of possessions but not having the fortune to enjoy it. Likewise, Northeast is not in our possession. It is having a geographic possession, but ontographically, psychographically, we cannot implant anything so easily there. So somebody should take that. Later on, anything that becomes a crisis, that's what I told in a seminar on crisis, everything starts with inconvenience. Everything starts with inconvenience. Then inconvenience mature into intervention. Intervention results in design transformation. Design transformation results in conflicts. Conflicts get into problems. Problems ultimately becomes crisis. We will wait till a small inconvenience becomes a crisis. Then it was there in the form of an inconvenience. You would have entered inside. That was not done by the people. These are the various things. And four pillars of our religion we have to believe. We believe our religion, there are four pillars. One is the temple. Temple is just a marketplace. Everybody can enjoy silence and solace except in temples in all places. That is the status. All Christian missionaries are centers of service. And all Islam madrasas are training centers. There is neither training nor service. Whether it is productive or destructive, that is different. But it is done or not. They have records for their actions. They have tracks for the action. Whether that is really fruitful or really altruistic or humanitarian, I don't want to explain that. That they are doing or not, that is the thing. So, temple must be the abode of three things. One is knowledge, second is worship, third is service. Come for knowledge. Mature the knowledge into worship. Divert the worship into service. This is the mode of each and every temple of our land and any temple. That should be incorporated in all temples, number one. Number two, we have to incorporate rituals. The power of our ritualistic sacrifices we should believe and incorporate for world peace and gaining more power to each and every action we should do. Rituals, that is also important. And third thing is samskaras. Each and everybody, we have been born and developed in a different culture, let it be. At least 100 people from 1 lakh society, like that there is a driver for 50 members bus, that should be social drivers, at least one member for 100 or one member for 1 lakh member, 100 people they should be taken for intensive training with samskaras along with modern education. So four pillars, one is sannidhi, temples, second is samskara, grooming the children, refining and reforming the children to be spiritually potent as well as to have the constitutional transcendental immunity against the growing problems of the society. Samskaras. The third thing is avana. We have to do a lot of pujas and worships like yoga, ayurveda. These limbs are to be practically distributed in the society. That is also very much important. And we should also believe in one system of tapasya. I have already told samskara means 100 people for 1 lakh is more than enough. If somebody is doing tapasya, one or two people is enough for the whole Bharat. Thousands of ants are biting a tree. It will take months together for trampling the tree. And a woodcutter is with an axe doing that. He may take few hours. But a ferocious titanic elephant can trample into pieces within no second. We want a trampling titanic elephant. That is a person in tapasya. So at least that should be a person. Our continuous prayer for God to send a person, or even if it is already available, to reveal such a person to society and have the mentality to accept and serve him, that should be given by God. That is the fourth pillar, tapasya. Everything is possible. What is the destination? By means of this tapasya, by means of this yaga and yoga technologies, by means of sannidhi and samskara technologies, we have to arrive at a good form of society, good form of government. Anybody getting a benefit is intermittent and interim. To form a government is the real desire, it is the ultimate desire, that is a productive desire. If you are benefited, you are only benefited for yourself for a period. If there is a government and a cyclic hierarchy of a benevolent dictator who is principled, in whose hands, if we are dominant, if there is the dominance is dangerous. But if there is a benevolent dictator in his embrace, even the enemies can enjoy the comfort. That's why Rama is known as Ripunamapi Vatsalaha. Even friends should suffer in the hands of malicious people. Even enemies can enjoy the divine rejoice and embrace in a benevolent dictator's rule. So by these four pillars of our religion, our tradition, we should pray, work for physically, intellectually and integrally and collectively to create a government in a decade or at least even a century or millennium, let it be. If you are not doing the duty, you are to be blamed. If the result is not there, you can blame your fate or even God that he has not granted. But do your duty. We have to form an imperial system wherein by everybody is taken care, where there is a possible potency to convert people, to reform people. If they are not ready, at least to see that they are totally outrooted. Social amputation or surgery is done so that the innocent, pious and virtuous members of the society can remain in eternal tranquility, happiness and prosperity. Narayan, Narayan.
But what I failed was, if adhyayan is the objective, then the basic identification of the conflict in the perceptions of the people living on this earth broadly has to be identified, which is being normally described as Western and Indian. But I feel it is materialistic and spiritual. And the difficulty is that even those who are on the side of Hindu religion, they have not understood spirituality in the true sense. Not only that, the Aptajnan, which you had indirectly referred, the Aptajnan is not being believed by the Hindus themselves. And therefore, they go by the ordinary concepts of religion and ritual, just as on parallel with the Muslims and Christians, and they are not different in any category. What I find is that the objectives of the world, the life has to be interpreted. And there is a difference, basic difference, that the 90% of the population believes that one time life on earth. They do not believe in birth and rebirth and the cosmological system of consciousness evolution practiced on this earth. Even in the Hindu religion, the world life is considered as Maya. And therefore, nivritti par approach is taken to life. Now, when we talk about sociology, socio-political developments and solutions of the world, either we have got to identify exactly on which field, Kurukshetra and Dharmakshetra. That is, whether you are addressing isolated social life, socio-economic life on this earth, or it is integrated with the spiritual objectives of life, which are not confined to only one time life on this earth. And unless this adhyayan is taken intensely, and unless the Shastrartha is done with the other religions on this earth, which the government avoids, the religion also avoids. And therefore it has stopped. What took place in Shankaracharya is not taking place now. Sarvadharma Samaparibhava, this is what even the Hindu leaders are talking about. So therefore the conclusion, Swamiji, I feel that the identification of the issues has not to be started only with the social current problems, but the spiritual content of that problem. And in that place, a lot of technology is necessary. The yoga, tantra, yantra, mantra, everything, and the achar, and whatnot. So therefore the question is, Swamiji, what do you call adhyayana really?
It is the essence. The spiritual way of life is for various people for various purposes. No doubt the liberation or realization is a part of it. It is not exclusively designed for only people seeking emancipation. There are four steps or four models of spiritualism. One is materialism. Second is absolute spiritualism. Third thing is materialism for spiritualism. Fourth thing is spiritualism for materialism. Absolute materialism is your instinctive play. Whatever there is an instinct, biological instinct, that is absolute materialism. That has no other significance at all. Realization of God and being in heaven or any other liberated abode and doing service is absolutely spiritual. Whatever you are having, the material responsibilities for the nation and family, wherever you execute some sort of promptitude, some sort of precision and perfection in each and every act, that promotes also your spiritual eligibility and adaptability. That is materialism for spirituality. If you have a spiritual prowess, you can undertake any problem, risk reduction, crisis management, opportunity understanding, trend management, marketing technology, self-introspective technology, self-management, stress management, business management, domestic governance, corporate governance, all of these material activities can be undertaken by a person who is spiritually potential. So there are four dimensions: instinctively materialistic, transcendentally, totally spiritual, and there is a possibility of material precision for spiritual eligibility and spiritual empowerment for material success. All of these things are rationally, reasonably possible in all areas, number one. And number two, in a classroom, in the attendance register or in the total strength of the school, you cannot include the cockroaches and lizards, as they are also dwelling in the same campus. Like that, religion consists of different people: Astika, Bhakta, Vaishnava, Prapanna, Paramaikanti, Ekanti, Astika, Nastika, innumerable members are there in the devoted community. Most of the people are going to the temples for just a change of place and time, just for justifying their mistakes, or as an absolution or some sort of saving from the mistakes, giving them power to commit more mistakes, or to compensate the already done mistakes and their impact by means of a divine bribery. Innumerable methodologies are added by people. They are not qualitative people. They don't constitute the qualitative membership of that religious community. So here I want to say that as most of the people rightly have said, they don't believe, even if they believe that there is a heaven or emancipation or total renouncement, there are three things. One is renouncement, they don't believe. Realization, they don't believe. Third thing is repatriation or going back to heart, that they don't believe. And number two, even if they believe, they don't want that. Even if they proclaim that they want, they don't behave like that. There are three problems. One is belief problem, and second is even if they believe, the necessity problem, need problem is not there. Even if it is that, there is a behavioral problem, third thing. So 10% of the members, they don't believe. 20% of the members, they believe but they don't want. 30% of the members, they believe, they want, but they don't behave according to that, compatibly. So 60% of the religious society, they are not like that. But why I have mentioned the tapasya and other things? Very simple. I am not talking about the non-believers. If somebody is not believing, not qualified, leave them. At least a handful of qualified people, as they are believing rituals and tapasya, they can start that. See, whenever you are given a job, why you are bothered about somebody who is not interested? Let you do and initiate that. This will create a radiative permeation in the society to instill faith in other members also, so that they can gradually come. So it is known as consciousness emergence. I have already told. You close your eyes, sit here and pray for at least half an hour very strongly. Just as terrorists are having a strong determination with the baggage they don't have. So with strong determination and repetitive prayer and beseeching, you crave for the divine intelligence to give you power, contact and connectivity with the other members of the society. You pray for half an hour, within 10 days you will meet somebody who is going to support you. It really happens. If you don't believe, how we can do that? So it is enough, more than enough, if you have 10 people to think about the national development. Because that is a cyclic, that is a permeant, that is a radiant, that is a multi-spread, multiplier benefit that we are going to get in the future. 10 people sitting together consistently, staunchly praying for the world welfare, within 10 days they will contact with 10 more persons. It will create a spiral circle of extended relations. You will get three things. You will get more resources. Number two, you will get more people. You will get more integrity within you with more power. So to get already existing your power multiplied, already existing resources multiplied, already existing limited group to be multiplied and extended, think about a concept, be clear and staunch inside that, persistently do on meditating, you will get it. You have to try. If you believe, experience it. If you don't believe, at least experiment it.
We are all impressed, not by it was a feast for years, but it is a your soul also, Swamiji. My a small question, which if I have not misunderstood. You, in the course of your lecture, you said that the animal sacrifice is also required to propitiate God. If I understood correctly, perhaps it's my misunderstanding also. Please explain a little to us that today we feel that sacrifice of any kind of creature is taboo to.
I told about seven issues like transmigration, caste and various issues of Hinduism which are challenges for its growth. Often it is accused by its opponents. And animal sacrifice is an issue. I am not an advocate of animal sacrifice. It is an issue. It is a belief of people that animal sacrifice is advocated in Vedas. There is a research which was done by some people. Bharat, Prachin Bharat mein Gomams ek Samiksha. They also published a research article on that. I have to say three answers for that. Number one, in spiritual terminology, just as we are doing animal testing, bioethically it has given a very big problem. For the welfare of a greater society, it is often accused as a species supremacy. Like human beings, they are having racial supremacy and fighting between people. Human beings, they are having species supremacy, so that they can torture any other living being for their development. So like that, there is also a special supremacy of human beings in which there is a process, it is known as Vama Marga or a prohibited or cruel Marga, with which the animal sacrifice that tempts a person to sacrifice something for his benefit, just as it is done in animal testing and various scientific exercise. There is also an inferior spiritual exercise in which it is sacrificed. Whether it is administered, whether it is advocated or specifically prescribed is entirely different. It is being practiced. Number one, point number one. Number two, whenever there is a possibility of getting into this flesh eating, which was inhabited in the primitive ages, unavoidably we have to accept. In order to mitigate them, there was created a very great ritualistic system for eating the meat. So to eat this amount of meat, you have to sit for 4 or 5 days together in a Vajpayee or somewhere there. And to eat this amount, you have to do lot of prescriptions and do lot of other sanctuarial methods even after the completion of the ritual. So that is known as mitigation. Selective prescription is there. But what the Shastra says is, Traigunya Vishaya Vedaha, so says Bhagavad Gita. The Vedas are meant for three types of there. If they are not taken care, they will resort into some other thing and totally lose the embrace of the Vedic system. That's why in order to bring them, see, whenever you go to somebody, even if a thief is there, if he wants to rob the chain of the child, he will first give what the child needs, a chocolate. Then he will take what he wants. Even in the spiritual observation method, these people, those who are cruel in nature, they are just in the pretext of a sacrifice, in the pretext of an offer, they are being linked with the system. Then properly, within the birth or gradually, over various births, those people, they are promoted towards Sattvika Guna, by which they will realize that it is a mistake. If this divine pretextual prescription is not there, then unlimited and non-systematic way of consumption or as well as hunting of animals would have been there. So in order to limit and to organize a habit, if you ask a person to immediately leave everything, he will ask for a second way. He will not come to you. So there is a pretextual design for that one. By means of rituals, there is a possibility for mitigation by exercising arduous exercises. Number two, the third thing is very simple. It is not administered for sophisticated spiritual authorities. In all other grown religions and civilized religions, at the time of maturity, they did not administer that. There is also one fourth rule that Vedas, they don't have animal sacrifice at all. There is one word known as Alamdhana. If you say Ashwamedha, he is killing a horse, then Pitumedha, you have to kill your father in the ritual. So there are lot of other linguistic as well as etymological derivations and expressions given in the research books, wherein they say that all the verbal base or root that has been interpreted to kill or to hunt or to destroy, everything is just meant for to touch. To touch. Alambana means Guru Hu Sishyamalabhate, means Guru touches the Sishya. There are a lot of words. Pashumalabhate, Agni Shomike, Shweta Pashumalabheta Vayu, Vaikshepishta Devata. So this is the Veda. Vayu is a very great Devata. Immediately he can be propitiated. So you have to give a white goat for that. So that Alabheta, here it means kill. There it means Guru Sishya, not kill, just to touch. So they have interpreted that. So there are four theories. One is a prohibition theory for the advanced people or the broad-minded people who should be the real goal makers and the exemplary models of the society. It is prohibited. Number two, to minimize it has been ritualized, to divert and systematize it so that it can be regulated and slowly extirpated from the society. It has been made in the pretext of village gods or sacrifice. Number fourth, in intellectual management, this has been clearly interpreted that it has been misinterpreted by people instead of touching for killing. These are all the explanations. Yes. Yes.
The sacrifice which in Sanskrit is called Yajna. In the Treta Yuga, the Yajna system and understanding deteriorated, degenerated, and Dravya Yajna was composed, the substitute, which was merely symbolic. Therefore, my friend's problem is that whether Himsa is involved. Actually, the animal is killed means the Pashu, Pashu Murti is killed. Now this symbolic meaning is lost, which was in the Vedas. And the degeneration took place, and the symbolic yajna, which became a ritual, which is being carried forward to this day. Even Vajpayee's election, they carry a yajna, which I fail to understand.
Yes, this is nice. There are Havir Yajna, Dravya Yajna, Pashu Yajna and Soma Yajna, in which juice is offered, meat is offered, a living being is offered, and these things are very common. And one also, one thing I want to say, the Shastras even say that there is one wonderful greatness of our Shastras. That's what I told you in the seminar on monotheism. Western religions are also monotheistic, we are also monotheistic. But they are radically monotheistic and we are rationally monotheistic. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, O Arjuna, I have created lot of deities and I have created the hierarchy of worship. And each and everybody, as per their taste, they worship their god, like food taste and language taste and their own cultural taste, they worship their own deities. gradually they are accustomed with the bondage with the deity and approach the Paramatman, the Supreme Being, myself. So where is that God who says that he has created all systems and each and everybody should gradually develop and he is the institute of faith in all religions and their respective worship? Where is that God? And where is this God who is saying that everybody should be destroyed? So that is radical monotheism, it is rational monotheism. Likewise in Vedas, one more quality is, if a person, for example, there is Shena Yajna. What is it? Shena Yajna. Shena Yajna is organized for destructing an enemy, killing an enemy. If the Vedas will not give a shelter for a person's desire to kill his enemy, immediately he will take some other measures to kill. Anyway, he is going to kill. He cannot be prevented. And he will be disturbed a lot. So the Vedas administer Shena Yajna. And after the completion of Shena Yajna, in that Nibandha, in that explanation, it says that anybody killing the enemy will get into a sin. For extinction of the sin, he has to go for Tirtha Yatra, he has to dip in various other bathing exercises and various other things. So the person realizes that it is sin. So whenever a person's immediate taste towards an act is not preventable by means of a strong admonishment or order, injunction, that order is immediately implemented by the Vedas. And gradually the person's mental transformation is also guaranteed by the Vedas. So if somebody is taking some sort of flesh or meat in the pretext of, it is not for sattvika people, it is only for the tamasic people, even if they take that, if it is not restricted, they will take more. That's why we used to say, apa dharma, yuga dharma, vishishta dharma, adhikari dharma. In this Kali Yuga, all these things are prevented. All these animal sacrifices, even if we accept that they have been exercised, they have been prevented in Kali Yuga. Because Kali Yuga, they know that apart from rituals, each and everybody is making sacrifice. Terrorist bombings, everything is a sacrifice. Now we have come to human sacrifice, not even animal sacrifice. So, if Veda says something, it is to come in your way, to bring us to our way, that is their way. So the Vedas are so kind enough to come in your way, gradually promote and organize your mental transformation, so that you can be very slowly and steadily incorporated into the Vedic design of non-violence. If you initially implement non-violence, if somebody says in Vedas that you come here, I'll give you wealth, I'll destroy your enemy, I'll give you some sort of benefit like Svarga, if you say that, they will come to these things. If you really enumerate by means of saying ethical injunction, nobody will come there. Even those who should not be deprived of the Vedic benefits, in order to have a pretextual incorporation of their invitation to get their immediate benefits, they are invited as if they are going to get the immediate benefits. Slowly they are injected with a transformation power by which they are also culminated towards a spiritual framework.